you're starting to. Father, thank you for bringing us here today. I pray that you speak through me and just give me the words that you want me to say, God. Help us to not be distracted. I know even me coming up here, sometimes I get distracted. And God, I just pray that you would keep us focused on you and what this is all about. It's about you, God. So we just pray that you will speak to us here today and just help us to come to you and love you with everything we have, God. Thank you so much for everything you've done for us. I pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, if someone were to ask you, what's the greatest thing? You know, what's the greatest thing out there? Then, you know, just think about that. What would your, I guess, your response, you know, be to that? What's the greatest thing out there? But even as I thought about asking that question, that's kind of vague. That's kind of like, so have you ever had anybody come to you and say, what are you doing tomorrow at 6:30? And you know, those are those things you're like, it depends. Like, what are you asking me? You know, because if you just say, oh, I'm free, they're like, great, I'm moving, so I need you to come help us pack up. You're like, no. So that's why I'm always like, I may have something. Why? You know, what are you doing there? Oh, I'm gonna, you know, I'm gonna give you $1,000. I'm like, well, I'm free. You know? So you never know things like that. So that may be kind of vague. You think about what's the greatest thing out there. I was looking on some polls, and it really was election polls, and it's basically said a lot of things that we know. I mean, it was the top things during the election season. It's like, I think it's like money. You know, we want to talk about our economy and different things in that way. Healthcare. It was immigration and different things in that way. Terrorism is up there now. You see some of the things that it goes down. You got education and all that. These big things that go down to the bottom, which I was kind of surprised at, like abortion and then like sexuality issues and you know, and just things in that way. Those are kind of the lower things in there. But that was, you know, kind of the poll. There were some different things in there just mixed in. But you look at that, what are the most important things that are out there? What do we think about our most important things in our life? And I would say, really, how you answer that. Well, I'll say this, okay, in a church, I'm probably, you know, you're thinking, if you're going to do something with church in that way. So I would think, it depends on, you know, your answer to that. It depends on your background, where you've come from, what kind of church you've come from, what things you've had to deal with. It probably depends on our history in different ways. Maybe you're going to look at that in some ways. But I would also say that how you really answer that question would be a good indication of how you look at God and how you live for God and ultimately how you just live in this world and how you interact with others. And again, coming into church, how you worship Him, and how you live, and how you make your decisions, how you answer that, I think is a really important thing. Well, there was a Pharisee, this religious guy, this Pharisee comes to Jesus and really asks Him basically the same question. And he went to Him, you probably know this is going to be in Matthew chapter 22, but he went to Him and he asked Him really the same question. He goes up to Him and he's like, what's the greatest commandment? What's the greatest sin? Now, these guys were going there all the time. They're trying to catch Jesus. They're trying to trap Him in some things and trying to get Him to say something wrong where they could point Him out and say, look, He's wrong. And so this guy's coming and saying, what's the greatest commandment? Now, these guys, these Pharisees, they get a bad rap a lot of times, but they knew the law. They knew it so well. They had it memorized. They knew all these things. They were, in a lot of ways, they were respected in the community as well because they knew this stuff. I mean, they were, you would think about just worldly standards. They're very moral people. So they had the law down. So he comes up to Jesus again and he asks Him, what's the greatest thing? What's the greatest commandment I need to follow? And if you've been in church long, you know this. You know there's two things He says here. Matthew 22, 37 through 40 is what I'm going to look at here. And Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And I'll keep reading it, but I'll just say this. The next one, really I always point out to people, you got to get this one before you can get anything else. And I would say if you truly get this first one, you'll get the second one, which is what He says here. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So I had you, you know, ask a question to yourself, you know, think about what's the greatest thing. Probably we're in the second week of love. Yeah, probably didn't, and He says that their love does. It probably didn't throw you off in any way. What's He going to talk to you about? Is it love? Probably didn't throw you off there in any way where... But that's the greatest thing. When He was asked this, what is this greatest thing? And it is love. And I'm going to talk about, really, our reaction towards God's love in us. And I'll say this is not what I'm talking about today, but all this is because God first loved us. He's the one who first came to us. He wasn't there off in some distance, and you and I just, in some way, we decided to go to him. He's the one who first went after us. So we got to remember that, and that affects everything and how we come to him. He's the one who first came to us. But we talk about this. What's the greatest thing? You come into church, and all of us probably still have questions, and even if you've been in church for a long time, maybe you've been a Christian for a long time, it doesn't matter. We all still have these questions sometimes. What's the greatest thing? What do I need to do? And it does. It comes down to love there. It's not perfect attendance in church. Although, as I say that, I'm starting a church and we're kind of low. I'm like, right now it does count. You need perfect attendance. So I really love that. But no, it's not about perfect attendance. It's not about, I said this even last week, I believe, about how much we can give. It's not you saying, well, this is all the places that I volunteer at. I volunteer at all these homeless shelters and, you know, feeding centers. I do all these things. I help out. I go on these mission trips, which we're going on one. It's not all those things. It's not how much you give to other people. It's not how many times you say God bless you to somebody when they sneeze. You know, it's not those things. It's not a list of all this good right here, and that's what really matters. But it does. It comes down to love, and that's what he talks about so many times throughout the Bible. Now, none of that stuff is bad. It doesn't mean we don't do those things. But it comes down to love. And I see this so many times throughout the Bible. God is just, he's telling us, it's about love. The greatest commandment, love the Lord your God with everything. Heart, soul, mind, and other parts in the Gospels and strength. Just everything about our whole life, it's about love. And then he says, and love your neighbor as yourself. Which we're going to talk about that next week. So if you guys will come back, and we're going to finish out the series on that. And how that really looks. And how we should respond because of God's love for us. How do we go out and respond to other people? And because I was even thinking about, we may talk about it a little bit next week, but just, we're in a place here where, you know, the mosque burned down, and it kind of made, I think, national recognition. I mean, there, I think there was another one in Canada and stuff, but pretty big deal. You know, like, Victoria's on the map. You know, I kept going on Facebook and seeing if somebody would be like, hey, Kyle, you live there, right? Nobody did. Nobody really worried about it. But, you know, it made national news. So I looked at that, and I thought, when I saw a couple of things there with that, maybe you guys saw it maybe on Facebook, just kind of noticing it and then even reading articles, is I think it brought up really maybe two confusions, I guess, that people have. One of them was, I think, well, what do I really believe? What can we believe? I think it did. It kind of caused people, as you see things like that, it causes confusion. Well, what can we believe? You know, what different religions? It kind of brings that to the forefront, you know, think about that. And then confusion, too, I think, maybe even on Christians, like, how do we respond to this? How do we respond to, you know, people? There's love. There's differences of beliefs there. What do we do there? And I kind of saw that confusion, not really knowing how to respond to that. So I may look at that a little bit next week, talking about that, but how we respond to people and to the world because of God's love. We'll talk about that a little bit next week. But you see that, and you go online, you go on Facebook, and just, especially probably at the beginning of political season, there's not a lot of love. It just seems like out there in a lot of ways. It's just something that's missing out there in our world. We miss it. We're quick to point fingers. Talk to my wife in a lot of ways, like now, because of social media, we see it a whole lot more now than probably what it was before. It used to, at least they talk about you behind your back, you know, somewhere else you don't need to hear it. Now it's like they're across the world and they're talking about you behind your back, but right there behind the screen, and you see it all, so it's a little bit harder to see all this out there. It's like, it doesn't seem like there's a lot of love out there. So what I want to talk about today really is that first one. It's just love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. I just put that up there just to remind us of the first part there. That's the greatest commandment. That's what he said. That's what it's about. And he goes back to even in the Old Testament. What's the main thing we got to get down? It's love God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and just everything that you have. Think about maybe it's something in your life where you really wanted something, and you know, you had to really sacrifice a lot for something. There's some kind of thing that you wanted. Maybe some people, this is what I thought about now, and I wish, you know, maybe I could go back, but maybe in high school, I didn't really work maybe all that hard, and I got through, it was fine. I wanted to go off to college, but in high school, I just kind of got through, just did sports, just hang out with friends, and did all that, and I really wasn't focused on, you know, my education all that way. Went on to college, you know, and all that, and then later, after I was done with college, it's like, okay, then I had to pay back, you know, loans and all that. And I'm like, man, I would have maybe paid attention. Maybe those ones that really worked really hard, got scholarships. You know, I don't know if you guys are like me. Maybe you guys are the ones that got scholarships. I didn't. And I look back and I'm like, man, after paying off those loans, I'm like, I wish I would have done better, you know, and sacrificed. and done some of that. And then some of those, maybe they went on and they got the jobs that they wanted. You know, you always see those maybe in the movies where people go back to those reunions, you know, and see the people and they're not the cool ones anymore. It's the ones who really worked, not getting into that. But, you know, just the sacrifices, the things that you did. Maybe it's the girl that you went after. You're like, I need to be with her. That's the one, you know, that I want to be with. And I'll say this, like, if you go through all that, and if it's not the one you're with now, you know, don't say anything. But make it kind of awkward right now. You can lie about it now. Just say, yes, it was you and stuff. But, you know, we have those things that we sacrifice so much that we want to go get it. We have so many things we'll sacrifice to try to get stuff. I remember when I was about 8, 9, 10, I don't exactly know the age, maybe around Melissa's age, maybe a little bit younger, we would go to this wooded area around our house, you know, it was kind of in town, but it was wooded area. We'd take our bikes right out there, and just there was creeks, and there was trees and stuff, and now I look back at it now, it's probably not the best place for, you know, little kids to be playing out there, but we'd go out there, we'd go play in these woods and do all kinds of stuff. And I remember going to this creek. And just to kind of set this up, I watched a lot of reruns of Beverly Hillbillies with my dad, you know, the whole show. And I watched some of that. And so I'm out there, and we're playing, you know, there's just this creek, and we're jumping across. We would get crawdads and stuff, and then you guys just kind of get those, and sometimes take them back to our little two-foot pool at the house and throw them in there just for fun, and we get in trouble for that. We didn't think at that time. But we were there, and I remember going to this creek, and I would step on it, and this like, black liquid, like comes out. You know, if you remember Beverly Hillbillies, I was watching that, and I see that coming out, and I'm like, we're going to be rich. You know, this is oil. I remember Jack Clampett, you know, and the song was running through my head of, you know, up through the ground come a bubble and cream. You know, and I just remember this, just looking, I was like, dude, Beverly Hillbillies, we're going to be rich, you know, just mansions, all this stuff, cement ponds, you know, we were going to be rich. And I thought about all this, and I was like, okay, we're 8, so let's go and get all our money. We need to buy this land, so we can have this land, so that we can, you know, put an oil rig on. This is in town. It was like a school right there and all this stuff, and I guess I thought there was oil there. I was like, we can buy this, we can have all this, and we can be rich. But that's really where the story ended. I never bought the land, never became rich, and did all that. I still don't know what that is, if somebody could tell me. It's by Greece. You can step on this mud, and this oil, whatever comes up, I don't know what it was. Somebody probably just dropped something out there, I don't know. I thought we were going to be rich. But I was thinking about that, if we could just buy that land and have all this, we would have everything. It was a treasure I wanted to sell out everything to, which I had nothing except my bike, which was worth like $1 million to me at that time. I want to talk about, not the Beverly Hillbillies, but I want to talk about these two really small parables that you may know. This is in Matthew 13, to kind of get this idea of this treasure and selling out everything to really get this, and how that goes with what I'm talking about, our love for God, and how that should cause us to respond to Him with everything that we have, and just respond, just give Him everything and not hold anything back. So I'm going to look at that. This is in Matthew 13. These two really small parables. Matthew 13, 44 through 46. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought the field." Just like I wanted to do that. "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it." So here's my question I would say is, what are you willing to give up for everything? What are you willing to give up for everything? And I know that sounds, maybe that sounds, is that worded wrong? You're looking at that, what are you willing to give up for everything? And probably just read it, you can read that over and over and just ponder on Kyle's thoughts. No, but what are you willing to give up for everything? I want us to think about that, because I think that's important for us to see there. What amount of stuff, what amount of things that are out there that we think is everything? We're going through this life, and I know how it is. I know we get up here, and the pastor gets up here and talks about it, and just, you guys got to just give up everything, go live for God. And it seems easy, just kind of throwing it out there. But we are. We're in this world right now. We haven't been into heaven. It's hard for us sometimes to picture God and what He wants to give us. And so when I'm saying we need to give up everything, that's hard. Because all our stuff, our home and our jobs and all these things, it's like, that is everything. And I get it. So I'm admitting, I'm with you guys, and it's hard to picture that sometimes. But what are we willing to give up for everything? When I'm talking about everything there, That's what I'm talking about, God, what He wants to give us. What we think of as everything we have here is temporary stuff. It's just things. It's just here, and then we don't take any of that with us. Mm-hmm. What are we willing to give up for God's version of everything? I think we've got to ruin it somehow. We've got to think about it. And so I'll point this out to you. I'm not up here saying, okay, I'm going to, you know, ask you guys to give this certain amount, you know, some type of prosperity message or something where you can have this stuff and get all this stuff in return. I'm not going to pass around the plate and ask you guys, okay, put this stuff in here and it's going to, whatever you put in there is going to just grow 10 times, you know, and like, can I get an amen, you know, and like, jump around and just add some dance. I can practice that. No, I won't do that. You know, I'm not asking you to do that, but I'm saying, where's the treasures in our life? What are the things that we consider our treasures? And compare that to what God wants to give us. And does it really even stack up to that? I read also the story about this farmer who went out and he lost his hammer out in the field. And he got it was his brother-in-law or something. They went out and they were searching for it. They had a metal detector. You know, I always wanted a metal detector so I could have some story like this or whatever. But he goes out and they're looking for it. And I don't think they ever found the hammer. But they found this, like this biggest 4th to 5th century Roman artifacts ever. Just amazing. I don't know how you just have a farm and how you find something like that. But it was worth like $5 million. This thing out there. He's out there looking for hammers. He finds this. And I'm thinking, you can buy a bunch of hammers. After all that, you know, it's like, what an amazing thing. I've never had a story like that. I found, when I was little, probably the same age. I got a lot of stories back then. But I found a $5 bill. We were walking out. It was big time. It was a $5 bill. And we were close to a Long John Silver. It was me and two other friends. And so we went in there, and that makes me sound old, but we went in there with $5 and we got meals for all of us. It wasn't like meals, it was like small things. You know, you can get like the crunchy kind of free stuff, and we got drinks. But $5, I was like, this is a good day. You know, got $5. Went into Long John Silver's, found a treasure, you know, not $5 million back then. That was a lot. It's like, hey, since this can go towards our land, we could buy the oil back. No, probably already forgot about that. $5. Never found anything like that. This was something big, you know, this guy found the treasure right there. Let me say this kind of a side note. With parables, they're not meant to, you know, you can read them, you can see this, but I just kind of want to point out that they're not meant to be exactly the same, like completely comparable to God. And I don't mean to, like, take anything away from them, but I just mean, like, sometimes some of the parables are not meant, like, exactly, this is exactly how it is. But they're analogies. They're meant to kind of give us a picture, you know, kind of highlight some points that he wants us to see about how God is in that way. And I think that's important for us to see that they're meant to kind of give us a picture of this is how it is. And I see this with these, and it's just pointing out what I think we've got to understand, what I really wanted you guys to get, is the kingdom of God, heaven, life with Jesus, is greater by far than anything out there. Amen. It's greater by far than all this stuff, all these things that we strive after. And I know it's so easy to get caught up in those things. I know it is. I mean, it's easy. I could get caught up in just building this church, honestly, and forget about life in Christ. I mean, I could just play the part. I could come here and put on a good show and actually be a good preacher and do all this stuff and could miss the point. You guys are supposed to laugh at it because, like, you are a good preacher. But you missed your cue. But you know, if we could miss all that, and forget about life with God, we could miss all those things. So I was reading this even, the second parable of the pearls. The pearl part, it talks about just the high value of pearls. They were big time back then. I mean, they're big now. That may even be my birthstone. I believe it is anyway, but it's a side note there. Trailing off it. But you know that this, listen to the outward, the second one's thinking. Pearls were of high value, still now, but really high value back then in that day. So he's pointing this out here for people to understand this and to see what he's talking about there. I even read that Julius Caesar decreed that only rulers of the Roman Empire could wear these. Because he's probably not wanting to like see somebody who's really poor wearing them and it's just going to like bring down the value. And I'm sure they're going to go, oh, now we can't wear them, you know, that way. So it was one of those things where only the rich, only the wealthy, only these high-ranking people can wear this. I read another thing, too, that said Cleopatra reportedly dropped a pearl into a glass of wine just because of a wager with Mark Antony and drank it so that she could say that she could consume the wealth of an entire nation in a single meal. You know, like, that's a bet. You know, like, that's an expensive bet. again, I've had bets with friends and drank stuff, ate stuff, really weird that I regretted. But it was nothing like this. It wasn't that big. It was probably like over $1, you know, something like $5 for, you know, Long John Silver's. That's a big thing. But he's pointing out again the high value of this. And so this guy going out and trying to find the greatest pearl. This is a big thing. Now, let me say this too. I know that there's different interpretations of these parables. Because I read these. There's different views of. Some say that these parables were talking about, okay, Jesus is the one who went out and, you know, bought the land, sold everything, bought the land. Jesus was the merchant who bought, you know, the pearls and stuff and kind of bringing us in and doing that. Others think, you know, like I said, it's talking about how we should be willing to give up everything. And I'll just say this, I don't think it really matters on those, because neither one of those is a bad, it's taking the Bible out of context. It's not wrong in any way. Jesus has done everything for us. He's given his life, he's given everything, so that you and I can actually have life. And then you look at this, you and I should be willing to just lay down everything and give up everything completely to him. So it's not right. It shouldn't be any type of argument on what's the way to really take this right here. Nothing is more valuable than life with Christ. Let me read just a few verses here. I kind of put them in here just for encouragement about this. This is in Romans 8:31 and 32. It says, "What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who didn't spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also bring with him graciously? How will he not along with him graciously give us all things?" Just read that chapter. I was thinking of just what part of that. I probably should have just read so much of it. But there's so many good things in that chapter of just the promises of God. You can go in there and read just his love for us and what he wants to give us and what he's actually done for us. And just the hope that you and I have. So again, you talk about the love of God and what he's done and how that should make us respond to him. It should draw us to him so much when you read these things. This is what he's actually done for us. This is how much he loves us. And it should just draw us to him like a magnet. How much that he actually loves us. Let me read another thing here. This is in John 14. Just about, I think maybe early on, maybe in ministry, I would read about heaven and I would read about how great it's going to be and all those things. But I don't know, I think there's a part of me that in some ways felt guilty for, you know, just thinking about how great heaven's going to be. You know, I was trying to be holy, you know, in a lot of ways. It's like, okay, I can't think about the greatness because that means I'm just going there for how great it's going to be. You know, just I think I was trying to be holy and, you know, I wasn't quite, you know, there. So, and I want to read this, and I don't think we should feel guilty. Let's read this and see how great it's going to be. Just a few verses here, 1-3. He said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. My father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and take you to be with me so that you may also be with me." And I know I talked about looking at heaven and some of the things that are there, but I just mean, think about it. Do you guys ever just sit down? I think it's great to sit down and just think about God and read theology and read how great he is and think about how we should respond to him and how holy he is and, you know, all those things. We need to come in right and see that we're not perfect and we don't deserve him. He came to us. But I don't think it's wrong to sit down and just think about his promises to us. Think about how great he is. And think about, these are true statements. This isn't something he just made up to try to make him feel good this time. This is what he said he's doing. He said, "I'm going there." He never lied. He's even pointing out that he said, if I was doing this, what I've told you guys, he said, if this wasn't true, what I've said this to you guys, and he's saying he's preparing a place for us. Those who trust in Christ, you have a home waiting for you. I don't know exactly what that means. I don't know. You know, we talk about these mansions and all this, and we sing old Audio Adrenaline song. You guys know the song? Picking up and come and go with me to my father's house. I'm not going to sing the rest. Okay. Somebody better start nodding. Totally lose the service here and stuff. But no, just you think about that, and he's actually planning a place for us. I don't know how that's going to be. I just know that the God of all creation who loves us, who spoke everything into existence, I don't know why he's in time, he's outside of time, but I'm just saying he's going to prepare a place for us. And he says that this is what's happening. If I told you this is true, you can always trust me. There's a home waiting for you. And so it's there. And again, what I just think that's amazing to me. If anything, whatever's going on in your life, I know that that's really tough, but you have hope in Christ. You have heaven as your home. We have heaven as our home. It's gonna be for all eternity. We're here for a little while. In fact, I just spoke with a guy the other day who just had a just a kind of a crazy past and everything. I was walking around the streets. It was kind of cool. It was one of those cool pastor stories. I was walking out and I talked with him and stuff, and he had some questionable beliefs for a little while there. But I got to talk to him for a while, and it was just his idea. He wanted to go to heaven. He was excited about it, and ready to go. And it was just, it was neat to see, like, his passion for that. And again, like I said, he didn't have the exact right beliefs, but he was like, if suicide was okay, I would go, because I want to go to heaven right away. And I'm like, okay, so do that. But, I was like, your passion to want to be with God, I'm with you, but we've got a job to do here, so pray for him. But you know what I'm saying? Just that passion of, we want to be with God. Paul wanted to be with God, but he said there's so much more to do here in this world. But again, I don't know what you're going through, but heaven is a home. That is the truth, and we need to remind ourselves of that. I think the church is here. We got to remind ourselves that that actually is waiting for us. It's there. He's promises. He's never backed down on a promise, and he's preparing that place for us. And to me, that's amazing. I love that. And so, just my question with this here, I'll say, is his price too high for you? His price of loving him, and he says, just are you willing to turn from everything else? Again, understand what I'm saying. I'm not in the place of God, and I'm not saying, okay, Kyle, he's going to pass out some contract and he's going to make me give away these things. I'm not saying that. I don't know exactly what you may have to give up in your life or what God will do that. That's his call and stuff like that. He's not telling us to walk out of here homeless and stuff in that way. But I'm just saying, we put stuff in the way of God sometimes, and we miss that relationship with him. Let me read these last verses here as I close out. Kind of strong here. Maybe not as encouraging as some of the other ones, but this is what he's asking us. He says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Again, you put all that in there, you talk about what he's asking us. He's asking love. He wants us to love him with everything. Not put anything in the way, not put anything that's going to distract us from him. Because again, that's the whole premise of Jesus. He's just saying, there's everything else, all this stuff, all the things, the richest things that we think we need to have, maybe even some of the stuff that we do have, that we strive for, that we sacrifice so much, and we said, I've made it, I've got all these things, all this right here, and it may be an impressive list. You may have all this stuff over here. He said, there's all that, and then there's me. There's all this stuff, and then there's me. And really, just honestly, the whole life of being a Christian or not, it just comes down to a choice. It's like, do I want all this stuff, or do I want him? This is sometimes our definition of everything, and this is his definition of everything. It's him. And it does, it comes down to choice. What are we going to do in that? What's our response to that? Because that's what it is. I mean, that's simple. We can make it a bunch of rules and regulations and all these things, and we do sometimes. We try to stack it up. We try to explain everything. We try to explain Christ to people. Sometimes we do that. I've seen it happen. We stack these things up. This is what it takes to get this. And it's like, no, it's faith in him. He's done it all. And what he's saying with all this stuff, what he's talking about with denying ourselves and picking up a cross and following him, all these things, is he's saying this stuff. Sometimes it's not bad. Sometimes you can even use this stuff for God. Ministry. And sometimes we need, I can even put like a house in here. That's not a bad thing. I'm glad I have a house. Just protection and food, all these things, or whatever, a job, But sometimes those things can become a distraction, is what it is, from him. We have these things and we think, okay, what is everything? And we tend to go over to this way and we look at these different things. And love for God, the number one thing, is not even in here. Sometimes I think it's more of a like. It's like we're here. It's like I have all this stuff. I like him. He's a good guy. I'm there with him. And there's passages in the Bible that, like I said, with this one, are a little more convicting. That James 2:19, it says the demons believe there's a God and shudder. The demons know there's a God and they're not going to heaven. They're not going to be there. And that's the point of it. It's not enough to just be over here and have all this stuff and say I like him. He's good there. He's asking us. This is a fanatical thing. This is a big thing. This is a life-changing thing that I think is it's tough sometimes, and even as a pastor, it'd be easy for me to come up here and just do encouraging things. I like that. I like getting laughter. I like to do those things. I like people to like me. But it's convicting sometimes. It's hard to not say these type of things, these strong things, where he says you got to deny everything and turn to me and live completely and totally for him. And I don't think we always do that. I'm not always there. He's asking us everything. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to love him? Are you willing to part with everything? Because that's what he's asking. Again, that's a fanatical thing. That's not easy. A lot of people don't want to hear that, but I mean, that's the truth. And the thing is, if we hold that back, are we really giving the truth to people? If I hold that back, am I really giving the truth in love? And I don't think so. I think we've got to understand that. So I just ask you guys, we're gonna close out here. Ask you guys to think about maybe some things that you're holding back in your life. Maybe things you need to give completely and totally to him. And how we can use that to move out to other people. Like I said, next week we're going to talk about how we can, now with the love of God that's in our lives and we've responded to him, how we need to go to the world and love them. We're going to talk about that a little bit next week, so come back to that. But today, I would just like to take a few minutes, if you guys would go ahead and bow your heads, to ask God, like, what are things that I'm holding back? What are things that you know, God, that are distracting me from loving you? Because the rich young ruler, if you remember him in the Gospels, he came to Jesus and he said, okay, what do I need to do? And remember, he laid out some things. He laid out good stuff. He was doing this, and it wasn't bad stuff. And Jesus said just one thing. Go sell everything you have and give it to the poor. I'm not asking you guys to do that. I'm saying Jesus knew his heart, and he knew what was in his way that was distracting him from loving him. And that's what I say. That's hard. That's hard, because if you know there's things in your life, it's hard to pray that. It's hard to really go to God and say, okay, God, what is keeping me from loving you with everything that I have? What is keeping me from having that close relationship with you that I need to have? And he's going to reveal that. If you're open to that, he's going to reveal it. If you don't already know it. And the thing is, I know it's convicting. It's all of us. We have those things. There's temptations. We are not perfect in this world. And it's not a list of do's and don'ts. But there can be things in your life that can distract you from to God. And so let's pray about that now. Together as a group, let's pray for each other and we can lay down those things and turn to him. So we need to do that. But we need to do that to live totally for him. So let's pray. Father, I pray for everybody here. Thank you so much. First off, you loved us first. You came to us. We didn't go to you, but you came to us. Thank you so much for that, God. We do not deserve it, and I thank you for that. God, I pray for everybody here, myself included. There's things that get in our life that distract us from following you. God, I know I can be easily distracted by things, and I pray that you would help me to not be distracted by things in my life, God. And I turn to you, and I just lay those things at your feet. And I pray the exact same thing for everybody here, God. There's probably convictions going on, things in our life, and we want to turn away. We don't want to admit those things because it's hard, God. But I just pray that you would help us see your love, God. And you're not there. You're not there to just beat us down and all this. You're doing this out of love. You know that these things can distract us from true love with you, God. And I pray we would understand it that way. We wouldn't understand it in a way of you're trying to be mean and controlling, but you're loving and you know what is exactly best for us, God. Help us to understand it that way, because maybe that's what's holding us up, God, from giving you everything. God, help us to see your love, see how much you actually do love us. Jesus, you came into this world and you died in our place because you loved us and you knew we needed it, but we have to turn to you, and I pray we would understand that. God, help us to just see your love and feel it so much more, and turn to you and completely live totally for you, God, so that you can use us in this world and we can go out to the world and tell them about you, God. I do what needs to be done in our lives today. Help us turn to you.